Hello everyone and welcome to another episode of Blabbing Translators. My name is Elena Tereshchenkova. Joining me tonight, or today, depending on where you're in what country you're based, is my wonderful co-host Dmitry Kornyukhov. Our guest tonight is Caterina Saccani. Hello guys.
Hello. Hi.
Blabbing Translators is the first live talk show where we talk about translation and translators. We talk about all kinds of things, really, from challenges freelance translators face every day to translation tools, to marketing tools. And today we're discussing going to translation conference. It's a great topic. I'm really excited about it. But first, Caterina, over to you. Tell us a few words about yourself.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Dmitry and Elena, for inviting me to this blab and for giving me the opportunity to talk about something I'm so passionate about. A few words on myself. I'm a conference interpreter and translator. I originally come from Italy, but I've been living in Germany for 4 years now. I specialize mainly in marketing, PR, and law and legal stuff. I'm a court certified interpreter as well. And as you've probably found out when you read about the topic of this blab, I'm quite passionate about professional development and CPDs. I organize translator gatherings myself on a regular basis here in Aachen and in Köln, in Cologne. And I have attended a few translator conferences in the past years. And in 2 weeks, I'm flying to Prague to attend BP16. And basically, that's all I want to talk about, past events and upcoming conferences.
Okay. Actually, when I was thinking about whom I want to invite to our blab, I thought about Caterina because I remember her article that she wrote on the open mic back in December. I was booking a couple of weeks ago. I was booking my ticket for my first translators conference, which is VP 2016. And I thought that it would be great to talk about attending translation conferences. And I remember that article. So how did the idea of writing it came to you? How did you get that idea, Caterina?
Well, needless to say, the open mic is a great platform. So thank you, Dmitry, once again for creating that amazing community. And
you're welcome. It's my pleasure.
So when you invited me to join in November, I decided to try just for the fun to publish a story on the open mic. So I wrote an article about starting out as a freelance translator about my own experience, and the reaction was so overwhelmingly positive that I decided, I decided to become a regular contributor to the open mic. So I just sat down and took some time to brainstorm about topics I could write about, or ideas, or something I have experienced before. And one of these topics is definitely CPDs, professional development, and translator conferences. So I wrote that article, and in that article, I kind of confessed being addicted to conferences as a funny way of saying that I've always had a great time at translator events. And well, I hope that would inspire younger translators or translators who usually don't go to conferences to invest more in their CPDs and to encourage them to attend more conferences.
So do you remember your very first conference? How was it like?
And the first conference I attended was the FIT Congress in Berlin. FIT is is a grouping of professional associations. So it's a worldwide organization, very big, very powerful organization. They held their 20th Congress in August 2014. And I read about that conference when I was still a student. So I was able to register for the conference and to purchase the ticket at a very ridiculously cheap price, at a very discounted price. I think the full price was about 400-500 euro, and I paid only 150 euro. So
that's a great deal.
Yes, so I would recommend to all students to attend their first conference and CPDs when they are still studying, because they might be able to take advantage of great discounts. So back then I thought that would be a great opportunity to meet many colleagues and to get familiar with the translation industry and to learn about the new developments and trends in this industry. So I registered for the Congress, and in August, it was, yes, from the 4th to the 6th of August, I attended this great conference in Berlin. And
so was it scary? going first time for.
I was really excited, I have to say, and sometimes I had the feeling it was a bit too much. We were like 1,500 registered attendees. So an awful lot of translators gathering in the same place. And the conference was great, and it really contributed to my professional development. It was quite difficult to make up my mind which session I wanted to attend, because there would be like six sessions going on at the same time. And I had just started out at the moment, so I tried to focus on those sessions which were addressing problems like marketing for translators and business practice, and also a few sessions on the specialization I had chosen, legal translation, for example, and marketing translation. And of course, I also attended a few talks by more prominent speakers like Chris Durban. I don't know if you're familiar with his name. Yes, yeah. A great session. She has a blog called The Prosperous Translator. And yes, she gave a few great pieces of advice for younger translators who want to try to reach out to prospect customers and clients. And another session I remember quite well was a panel discussion on machine translation. And that's what's the main topic. That was the main topic the conference was centered on, about the conflict between man and machine, possible, yes, cooperation, but also the challenges and threats that machine translation poses to our industry and to human translators. And for me at the time, it was quite exciting to see this senior established translators to discuss about the challenges and the newest trends in our profession and the future of our profession. So maybe it could sound quite exaggerated, but in those days, I had the feeling that I was witnessing some sort of historical happenings for our profession. And I had I had the feeling I needed to share it with someone. So I started tweeting about the conference. I was already quite familiar with Twitter at the time. And this is another important aspect I wanted to talk about. At that conference, I realized how powerful Twitter and social media can be when it comes to building a community. And yes, I started like sharing quotes or something I'd heard at the conference using the hashtag of the conference. And everyone, like all colleagues that weren't able to attend the conference, were very grateful to me for sharing news and information from the conference. And back then I had the feeling I was achieving a different status in the industry. Like I was being perceived as an expert, as someone who had something to contribute to the translators community worldwide. So I wasn't just one more newbie destroying the market for her competitors. And I remember that at that time I got very excited about getting 40 or 50 new followers within 3 days. But my community didn't only grow in terms of followers. I just connected to more people, had a better reach. Yes, it was a great feeling. And then I realized that translators conferences are not just about sitting there all the time and learn something and be passive. There's also a networking part which comes with each conference, and it's one of the best parts of each conference. You have, beside the sessions, you have lunch and coffee breaks, which are usually included in the ticket price of the conference, so you won't have to spend you won't have to buy your own lunch. And then you have the so-called fringe events, which are events or parties or dinners which are held before or after the conference or in the evenings, but anyway they almost never overlap with the sessions. And I remember having some great conversations during these lunch and coffee breaks. For example, I remember once I was having lunch, and I came across the person who was in charge of the mentoring program in the Association of Conference Interpreters, and she told me more about these mentoring programs. And a few weeks later, I have applied to this program. And as you can read in one of my open mic stories, well, it helped me a lot. So I was very grateful. I had kind of feeling I was in the right place at the right time. And
did you make a lot of connections back then? When was it? When was your first conference? In 2000?
2014.
2014. Did you make a lot of connections that last to this day?
Yes. At FIT Congress, I did some connections which lasted in these days, but because I met those people again. FIT was it was a bit too much. It was too many people, so it was quite difficult to connect. And that's the reason why I enjoyed my second conference much more, which was the YAPTIS conference in Berlin, in Bordeaux, in France. This was last year in September. And YAPTI is also an international professional association, but unlike FIT, it's not like FIT is a grouping of different associations, so it's much, much bigger. At YAPTI's conference was a on a much smaller scale. Like we were, I think, 150 attendees or something like this. And it was much easier to connect, also to talk, to approach the speakers. I don't know if you wanted to ask a question about to ask the speaker a question about his or her his or her talk. So I would say I liked it better for this reason.
So it was more. I would probably we could say that it was more. Not friendly. Friendly is not the correct word. More
like cozy. Yes, yeah. Cozy. That's
cozy.
That was the word I was looking for.
Yes, much cozier. And one of the things I've liked the most about the YAPTIS conference was like in Bordeaux, I met some colleagues for the first time. Mm-hmm. I had only been in touch with via Twitter or other social media. And one colleague said it was like meeting some pen friends, like having pen friends and corresponding with them for a long time. And then eventually you meet them in real life or in 3D. And that was a great feeling about that conference. And then the fringe events were also great. I attended the gala dinner. Mm. Everybody was suiting up for this gala dinner, which, let's be honest, is something you don't get the opportunity to do every day, being a translator in your home office. Singing and dancing together, and of course the talks were great as well. What I really appreciated about YAPTIS conference was that enough time was dedicated to and space was dedicated to talks about interpreting as well. So not only written translation, but also the program included a few very interesting presentations for conference interpreters. I remember I attended one great presentation about new technologies for note taking in conference in consecutive interpreting, which was quite exciting for me. Then another session about this pen, this magical pen. I don't know if you've ever heard about it. Which allows to mix consecutive and simultaneous interpreting at the same time, and another very interesting talk on interpreting by Tony Rosado about how interpreters should set their fees, how they should set their price, and how they to calculate their prices basically. And then a few names you've probably heard of, like Marta Stelmaszak. She gave a brilliant talk about goals and strategies for freelance translators. Then Valeria Liperta gave a great presentation on branding and storytelling. Another colleague gave a talk about the talk was called $1 million translator. So how to become, how to make six figures income a year.
Okay, let's focus on that. How?
Well,
we need to know now.
we had three pieces of advice. Specialize, specialize, and specialize.
Makes sense.
Yes.
So that is the whole talk.
At least you know what to do, and then you give a few tips on how to become more productive and efficient. And I have to say I haven't put everything into practice yet.
You mentioned that one of the conferences you attended, it was also a conference you combined with a vacation. Was it this one, the IAPT one?
Yes, it was the IAPT one.
Can you tell a bit more about it? Because that's what I'm actually doing in a couple of weeks.
Yeah. Yes. The conference was on 2 days, Friday and Saturday. And I flew to Bordeaux on a few days before, on Monday. So I just combined it with I made a summer vacation out of it. And I took some time to visit the city, to do some sightseeing. I traveled to the seaside to get a last glimpse of summer, to sunbathe, to relax before the conference. So I spent 1 week in Bordeaux. And I would recommend everyone to combine a conference with a holiday, because it will save you some money. Like, you're flying them there anywhere for the conference, so why not taking advantage of the time you spend there to explore the city or try out the local food or. Mm. Or beer or wine, like it was the case for Bordeaux. The wine was perfect. I also visited the wine museum. And yes, I plan to do the same in Prague and for every other conference I'm going to attend. Some conferences will some organizer usually offer guided tours of the city as a fringe event, networking event. I remember the conference in Bordeaux. Also, some colleagues went to a wine tasting trip in Bordeaux or in the surroundings.
Do you usually go to many fringe events when you attend conferences?
Well, if it were up to me, I would go to as many fringe events as possible. I would like just attend all of them. The problem is some of them are quite expensive. Quite pricey, like gala dinners. Gala dinners are usually quite expensive, like 60 to 70 euro. But I think it's worth it all the same, because you will just have a lot of fun and connect with other translators, and like exchange ideas and views, and you know, maybe you will become some piece of advice or idea, which will save you a lot of money later, or you will meet something which you will do business with at a later stage. So don't underestimate the return on investment of such events.
Yeah, I think it's a good point of view to view these conferences and going fringe events as well, to view it as an investment, not just
yes.
cost.
Yes, it is an investment on your professional development, because I've met a translation event. I've met a lot of colleagues who have recommended me to their clients later, and or maybe who have outsourced some work to me. So I would say it was definitely worth it And at the same time, I've had a lot of fun because, I mean, it gives you a great feeling, you know. You have the feeling you're doing something very, very good for yourself and for your professional development. And at the same time, you're sort of escaping the isolation, which comes with freelancing and networking and working from home or working alone in the home office. It's a great motivation boost because you will meet people who are as much in love with your profession as you are and who face the same challenges, who have the same problems, and you may help each other and find a solution. And maybe, who knows, maybe later you will start doing business together or working on a project together.
Can you give some piece of advice for people who think that they're not very outgoing and don't have that kind of personality? What can they do to make it a bit easier for them to go to their first conference? Any tips how to be more open-minded? Because some people label them as introverts, especially in our profession. A lot of people think that they're introverts. I also think that I'm an introvert, although I'm not, because I'm doing this thing right now. It's not very introverted, right? So, but still, we have this, just like something tells us in our brain, maybe because it's because of isolation or because we work all alone, that we are introverts. But sometimes people just tell them that themselves. How can we overcome that? How can we, what kind of advice can you give?
Yes, I consider myself to be what is called a hybrid personality. Well, actually, I consider myself to be introverted as well. But then I think, well, I would be doing something like this if if I were introverted. So, well, first of all, if you are introverted, or if you are, let's say, if you are in doubt whether to label yourself as an introverted or not, don't just take it easy. Don't put yourself under too much pressure, because otherwise you will be like exhausted by the end of the conference. Like in Berlin, I was, I remember at my first conference, I was asking too much from myself. I was like looking at people and thinking, oh, maybe I should be talking to that person because he's a very established translator. So maybe he could give me some advice, and or maybe he or she might send some work my way. But if you go with that mindset, you will put yourself on a lot of pressure. So just take it easy, be yourself, and I think the best people and opportunities will just come your way. And maybe you could brainstorm about some small talk and ice-breaking topics, like, for example, like I told you before, if you think you have missed a very interesting talk, you can ask someone who attended that talk to maybe to give you a recap of the talk, what did the speaker focus on, or maybe you can approach the speaker and ask him or her if he would be so kind to send you the presentation of his talk. Try to connect with in a way that comes more natural to you. Just don't try to be someone you are not. Don't force you to be more extroverted than you are, because you'll be fine.
I think about this thing about introverts. Many of us are introverts, but actually I read somewhere that introverts are not people who don't like to communicate with others. It's just people who refill their energy level while on their own.
Yes.
it doesn't mean an introvert doesn't mean that I want to hide somewhere from everyone. And this approach to the definition of being an introvert is something that changed my perspective on the whole thing. This is one thing. And the second thing, sitting in an office or at home the whole day and working, this is my comfort zone. So getting out that comfort zone is always scary, and saying that I'm an introvert, so I won't do it, it's just staying in my comfort zone. And that's, I think a lot of people might use it as an excuse. And I'm sure that I, at some point, I also used that as an excuse. So,
yeah, and attending a conference is something which definitely expands your comfort zone and your horizons. But that's perfectly right. I'm also someone who recharges her energy when she's alone, and I'm also very thoughtful. So just plan enough time to be, if you're introverted or if you feel you are introverted, just plan enough time to be on your own. Mm. Like, you don't have to attend all fringe events and join all parties. Just take enough time to relax and get rid of the feeling that you are missing something, or that the coolest translators are elsewhere and you are missing that session, whereas you should be there, or that you should be connecting with more people or doing more, because after all, you've spent money, you've paid a lot of money for the conference, so you want to make the most of it, you want to have the best return on investment. That's perfectly fine, but don't ask too much for yourself, otherwise on the last day of the conference you won't be able to get up from your bed.
We have a couple of great comments from Giovanna, and I want to read them out for our listeners who listen to the recording of this blab. Many conferences offer first-timers welcome committees and activities. Also, read the program. Pick what matters to you. Decide what your main goal is and select events and sessions based on that.
Yes.
Thank you for your input, Giovanna. And we also have a question from Eric. He's asking, Caterina, when visiting a conference, should one visit as many sessions as possible, or maybe leave one session out and doing some network on the corridor? A great question. Yes, I also wanted to know.
I've met several colleagues at FITS Congress for the first time who told me they preferred to skip at least one session at each conference to devote more time to networking in the corridor, which actually is a very good idea. I didn't do that at my first conference because I thought I was there to learn something and I was very greedy to learn something new. But I did so on my second conference, and it really pays off, because there won't be much many people hanging around during the session, but once again, less people means that it's much easier to connect with people and to build relationships that are bound to last. So just you don't need to skip a session you're interested in, but you won't be interested in all sessions. So there might be one block you're not particularly interested in. So why not use that time in a more efficient way in that case to do some networking in the corridor?
Okay, I thought that we could probably get to your most recent conference where you also were a speaker, where you also were doing a presentation. How did that happen?
Well, it happens quite casually. I decided to attend the conference as a regular attendee, and about 6-7 months before the conference, the association, so the DVUD, which is a German, a very new and dynamic association for interpreters and translators here in Germany. They announced a call for papers, which means that all attendees are encouraged to make, to submit a proposal for a presentation on a topic they are familiar with, and they have some expertise on. And I decided to try just for the fun, to submit a proposal. So I sent my paper about search engine optimized translation, which is a topic I had become familiar with during an internship in Beijing in China. I had to, yes, the internship was about, it was a project, it was about translating, it was a Mandarin school, language school in Beijing, and they wanted to have their website, their English website translated and to localized into the main languages. And they would have interns do this, and I was selected for the Italian internship. So I translated this website, and I had to research keywords first, research which keywords were more popular on the Italian market and in the Italian search engines, and try to integrate these keywords in my Italian translation of the website. So I thought it would be an interesting topic, like to share my experience on this project and my expertise about search engine optimized translation, which I had achieved during this project. But to be honest, I didn't think that my paper would be selected, because I was quite new to the profession back then. And yes, I didn't have so high hopes that I would be, that my thought would be, my topic would be picked. So when I got the email saying that my presentation had been selected, I was like, oh my God, I'm giving a speech at the translator conferences. And it was very, very new to me. But then I took a deep breath and I told to myself, keep calm and do some planning. You still have 6 months ahead of you. It's plenty of time. You will manage and you'll be fine. And in fact, everything went fine.
Were you nervous?
Yes, I was quite nervous, but I would recommend everyone to try this experience all the same, because you are terribly nervous a few days before the conference. And of course, immediately before the conference, like half an hour before, you go on stage, and you sort of, well, you get into your talks and you are confident because you have prepared your speech. So you sort of get used to it, and at some point you feel at ease. And you relax and you just enjoy it. And it's a great way to expand your comfort zone, like I said before, to get more familiar with your topic. And also, I realized once again that I had achieved a different status in the translation industry. I was being perceived as an expert for that particular topic. So once again, I wasn't just one more newbie coming around and spoiling the market prizes and asking everyone for advice and bothering everyone. I had something to contribute, some added value to offer to the profession. I was familiar with a topic most of my colleagues knew little, few or very little about. So this is a very good feeling. And not only the colleagues, I didn't only get positive feedbacks from the colleagues who attended my talk, but also by the ones who weren't able to make it to the conference, but read about the conference all the same. And yes, it's like a resonance effect. Yes, people get familiar with your name and realize you also have some contribution to make. So just, yes, speak up because you have something to tell, you have something to contribute.
Very interesting. We have a couple of our comments from our audience. I personally have a group of colleagues. We check who is going to which session and arrange to exchange notes. I think that's a very good tip.
I think that's a very good tip too. Mm-hmm. And what I also wanted to say, thank you for this question, because it brings me to something else I want to mention. Most presentations will be made available to the conference attendees in some form, like conference proceedings, like this.
Mm.
This is what I got at FITS Congress.
Holy moly.
Yes, like the proceedings of all talks. And this is just volume one, because you also have volume two.
So this is where all the money go to, printing books.
Yes, exactly. Or like you will be able to get to access the presentations, or to read some abstracts. So don't worry too much about missing talks. And yes, it's a great piece of advice to just arrange with colleagues that each attends one different speech and then exchange notes.
I think it also helps with networking and with building connections. Building,
exactly.
I wouldn't even call it networking, but building relations, because you provide value to some of your colleagues and they give you something in return, I think it's a great thing.
Mm. Yes, it's a great way to break the ice with your colleagues. Mm-hmm. And one other thing I wanted to mention about if you give a speech at the conference, so if you, yes, finally make up your mind and say, okay, I'm gonna give it a try, and just make sure you plan everything on time, that you do some careful planning. Like what helped me a lot was making a worksheet. Like by the end of week one, I want to read myself through the literature, and by the end of week two, I want to be done with the outline, then arrange my slides, my presentation, then check all links, add some pictures, and make sure if you're giving the speech in a language other than your mother tongue, just plan enough time to have your speech proofread by a native speaker or by a colleague. Mm-hmm. And also plan enough time to rehearse. Mm. Maybe one in front of the mirror or in front of your cat or boyfriend or your mother or whoever or a colleague. But rehearse and you will feel much less nervous.
Did you use a cheat sheet?
What? I'm sorry?
Did you use a piece of paper to help you during your talk, or you just go with the flow and take everything from your head?
Good question. I think I had planned to make a few notes.
Mm-hmm.
But then I was worried. I was not really comfortable with it because I was worried about colleagues noticing that I was reading from a piece of paper. So looking less self-confident than I was. So I tried to learn it by heart, but yeah, more or less I had an idea of what I was talking about. I had a plan. I had it in my mind, and I was able to retrieve most of it. I don't think I got mad at myself afterward because you should have mentioned that and that, and you left out that, and you forgot about that. So no, it's just take it easy. But
did you have slides?
Yes, I had slides.
So that helps a lot too, right?
Yes, that helps a lot. Yes.
Did anyone come up to you and talk to you about your presentation? Any members of the audience?
Yes, they did.
Did they ask questions?
They asked a few questions, and most of them were very encouraging and and positive, and also constructive. So it was definitely a great experience, and I'm looking forward to the opportunity to do this once again.
Very interesting. So you only been to Translators Conference. Have you ever been to any other non-Translators Conference, like in your field of specialization, for example, like conferences of lawyers or anything like that?
Yes, I've been to a seminar, a workshop on internet law, but I have to admit that I was the only woman, and I was the only non-lawyer, so I was like, I was a bit frozen, let's say, and a bit scared, so I didn't manage to connect to many people because I was a bit shy and not feeling really, really comfortable, I have to say. But I did attend another great event on one of my in my field of specialization, which is online marketing and PR and communication. And that was way much better because it was a very mixed audience. So I was just able to mix with the audience and to connect with people I could relate to, or which suited me, who suited me most. I felt much more comfortable, let's say. Mm-hmm. It was a so-called bar camp. I don't know if you are familiar with this format.
Can you mention it, describe it?
A bar camp is like a conference, but much more informal. Bar camps are also called unconferences, because or anti-conference or whatever. The main difference from regular conferences consists in the fact that the conference schedule is created on the same day. So according to people will just come on stage and submit a proposal for a presentation, and then according to how many people are interested in that topic, you will create a plan for the session, like this this speaker is going to talk about this in this room. And one great thing about bar camps is that they're way cheaper because they are sponsored events. So like at these bar camps we would have some biscuits or the cakes will be sponsored by the baker or by this cake or biscuit manufacturer. So I just paid 30 euro for one day, and the speakers were real experts on their field. I attended talks on newsletter marketing, on digital communication, on social media, of course, on the Twitter tools, a lot of interesting stuff. And yes, another great advantage of this kind of unconferences is that you can leave the room at any time if you don't enjoy that a presentation very much. You can leave at any time and join another discussion or presentation. It's allowed. It's not forbidden. Whereas at traditional conferences, attendees are usually asked to just make up their mind and stay in one room, not move back and forth a lot of time, because it might be very annoying for the speaker.
So it's more, it's a much more informal thing.
Yes, it's much more,
much less formal.
Much less formal, exactly. But nevertheless, most speakers are very very familiar with their topics. And most of them usually prepare a short presentation because they just rely on the fact that they are very very well known speakers, and that of course their presentation will be selected. There will be enough people interested in their topic. So they usually have presentations and slides, and everyone is encouraged to ask a question, to start a discussion, to share their opinion, their views, or ideas, or whatever.
That sounds like a lot of fun.
Yes, yes. And it's much cheaper. So if you're on a low budget, maybe you could consider this alternative format.
I was wondering between two different types of conferences for translators and conferences that in your field of expertise, which one brought you more value?
That's also a very good question. The translator conference brought me a much more tangible value, because I met colleagues who, and I connected to colleagues who recommended to me to their clients. So it paid off to attend such conferences, and I learned about ideas or tools or technologies which I could immediately apply to my translation business. Whereas conferences in my field of specialization, which it's more difficult to say which value it brought me. One of the greatest advantages of attending some conferences, this kind of conferences, is that you get to know your prospect clients much better. So you learn about the how they think and about the problems that they experience, and you sort of think about how you could solve their problems, and then you just, it's like about name dropping. You got acquaintance with the industry, and it's something you can also mention in your marketing copy, that that you're always up to date with the latest news and trends within your industry, and you will learn more about your field of specialization, which will result in more credibility. You will gain more credibility towards your customers, and also gain a lot of self-confidence.
Mm.
something
So
I would have to
basically,
come.
both events, they have their own value, but it's a little bit different in both cases. While
Exactly.
translation conferences are
Yes.
good for making connection within the translation industry, the conferences in your field of expertise are more about getting to know your clients and understanding
Clients,
their
definitely.
needs. Yeah.
Yes.
So you would recommend visiting both, I guess, right?
I would recommend both. I would recommend to maybe at the beginning of year start when you create your business plan, try to allocate your resources and your money to this different kind of events. Try to focus yes on your area of expertise and try to include translator conference as well as events in your target industry as well.
Wonderful.
We still have a little time, so I wanted to talk to say probably a few words about the upcoming BP conference in Prague.
Yes.
Why did you decide to go there?
Well, I had followed the news about BP 14 and BP 15 on Twitter and on Facebook last year and the year before, and I had the feeling I was missing something, that I should be there at that moment because all cool translators were going there, and that there were great presentations going on. I was just, well, I mean, if you follow news on Twitter, you will get a glimpse of it. You will get. Maybe you will read some inspiring quotes, but it's not the same. And so I decided that no way I was gonna miss BP 16, and I registered. It was before the early bird, still in the early bird period. And yes, I'm definitely looking forward to it and to meeting you in person, Elena.
Yeah, me too. I tweeted about it last week. I thought I said I wrote that I have a feeling that I know at least one third of attendees. I had some
Yes.
kind of communication with them. So it's amazing. It's an amazing feeling, and I'm sure that it's going to be really great, an awesome
Yes.
experience.
Probably
But
gonna be very very surreal to
yeah.
finally get to
Yes.
meet people in the flesh, not just some
Yeah.
avatars behind your
Yeah.
lines, real people. Yeah. Well, hey guys, we are almost at 1 hour mark. This was a very wonderful and very insightful talk, Katerina. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. You brought us a lot of great tips and a lot of interesting thoughts about attending conferences. Thank you so much for that. I hope this would inspire people who are still not very comfortable about going outside of the comfort zone, and encourage them to go out there and join people and meet people in real life, because that's very, very exciting opportunity to learn, meet and connect and build online presence and offline presence. So,
Yes.
thank you so much.
I hope I was able to convey this feeling that and to inspire people. And yeah. Thank you so much for inviting me to this lab.
You're welcome, and you're always welcome to come anytime as a viewer or as a guest again if you want to. Yeah.
It
So,
would be awesome.
thank you guys for watching. For everyone who's gonna be watching this in a recording, and if you missed it, please visit our website, blabintranslators.com, and sign up for our mailing list. That way, you will never miss another episode, and you will be able to join us live and have a conversation with us in real time, ask questions, and have a lot of fun. Thanks again for watching, guys, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Have a good day.